Monsanto has booked his spot, but there are more spots on the line. And coming up next, we are going to have quite possibly the best name in the tournament, Hot Meowth, coming up against Roof Trellin. They both had fairly straightforward routes here, as you can see, from a player who has gone all the way through the winner's bracket. Just saying, probably the standout name, one of my picks to qualify. Unfortunately, Hot Meowth dropped him down into the lower bracket on his way. Phone Tap as well, they're taken out. Roof Trellin probably Shoop, the biggest name that he's had to eliminate to get here. But still, this is the big game for both of them now, looking to follow players like Monsanto and get themselves a spot in the Summer Championship. But standing by to take you through this one are Cora and Admirable.
Thank you very much, Soddle. Welcome back to the desk. I am joined once again by That's Admirable. And what a match we just had. A day full of decider matches. Admirable, how do you think it's gone so far?
Well, Yogg definitely decides a lot of games, but the fashion in which Yogg decided this game, I think, is quite unlike something I've seen before. There's been a few powerful five-spell Yoggs, but nothing quite like that one.
And we may be seeing one again this series. Roof Trellin does have that Yogg Druid, but Hot Meowth chose not to bring a Druid, actually. Paladin Warlock Warrior with a Shaman ban on his side, and the Druid Mage Paladin with a Shaman ban on Roof Trellin's side. So what do you think about the double Shaman bans?
Shaman bans, I think, just line up well with exactly the way they've built their lineups. I mean, Hot Meowth has a Murloc Paladin in his, Roof Trellin has an Azoth Paladin in his, as well as the Mage with Cabalist Tome, and that build does not function very well against a deck that quite literally wants to just play minions and attack you as quickly as possible with a lot of burst to back it up. The Mage needs a lot more time to get value from Cabalist Tome. The Azoth Paladin deck, it can take on Shaman, but I think it's a matchup you tend to want to avoid. It's really, really focused on whether or not you have Doomsayer early on sometimes. So rather than focus his build there, just go ahead and ban out Shaman and move along your way. And from Hot Meowth's side, looking at the Shaman that Roof Trellin has brought, It's got Bog Creepers, it's got Halazeal, it's got Elemental Destructions and Farsights. I feel like his lineup may just be a little too slow to handle that deck in particular.
Yeah, and we've actually been talking a lot about the Tempo Mage. It's been very prevalent in this tournament so far, but we've mostly been stressing the addition of Firelands Portal, which is one of the new Karazhan cards. But that Cabalist Stone we've seen come up a couple times as well. Now, what do you think about the inclusion of that as opposed to, you know, some other possible tech cards in the Tempo Mages?
I'd imagine it's a list that players are just a little bit more familiar with. You know, Firelands Portal being recent, it's difficult to find a lot of games that you could play with a list that you're necessarily comfortable with. So we're going to get into game number one. It's Dragon Warrior for Hot Meowth and that N'Zoth Paladin for Roof Trellin. And Ivory Knight. Ivory Knight seems to be, like, I think, the big talk of the tournament in terms of where tech cards are concerned.
Yeah, I really like it so far. It's definitely proven that you usually get a significant amount of heal when you need it, and it has been very useful, even in the Paladin decks that already do heal so much. But one thing that is just very, very interesting about this N'Zoth Paladin on Roof Trellin's side is the inclusion of a Shifter Xeris. Admirable, I can't remember ever seeing one of those in competitive play before. Have you?
From Dark Peddlers.
Fair enough. I mean, you could potentially Shifter Xeris into a second N'Zoth or a third Ivory Knight.
I think it's just waiting for the right moment. You know, sometimes it presents an opportunity. And I'm not sure that's worth a card slot, but it's been working out for him so far. You know, this is the sixth match these guys are looking for here. Both players had a buy in round one with the seeding and the number of players that are in the bracket, it'd be double elimination. And at this point, they're also 12-4 on their game records. It just really cannot get this much more evenly matched, and especially with a couple of interesting choices. And I think that's sort of the standout thing to me between these two is the choices are not super standard across the board.
Both guys also have some pretty evenly matched opening hands, both with a pretty nice mulligan. Hot Meowth goes ahead and plays that Finley and gets the Life Tap, which is really, really essential for the Dragon Warrior in a lot of matchups. Why would you choose something like the Life Tap over Steady Shot, for instance, in this matchup?
Well, in this one, it's like card economy. So all of your big minions are real threats. And since the Paladin isn't applying a lot of pressure to you, finding more big minions is usually an easy way to win the game. And so when you're playing those slower matchups that can tend to be a little bit more grindy, having extra card economy and trading your life for it, since you're not being pressured, it's not like you're losing anything almost.
Yeah, it's definitely a really nice addition. Hot Meowth does have a way to remove this Doomsayer. He's got the Execute in hand along with Blood to Ichor, something that is really didn't seem like it was going to be, you know, a huge addition in Warrior decks, but has proven itself time and time again in many variations of the class's decks. But he's just going to go ahead and coin out that charge minion, clear off the Doomsayer, and puts himself in a pretty nice spot. He's got a nice board.
Yeah, this is a situation where I think Hot Meowth could have justified an execute, but getting the Core Chronolite on board, this puts Roof Trail into a really big pressure test where if this doesn't get answered, Hot Meowth could run away with the game. And so that's like the main focus here. It's about the earliest stage that this is possible. Roof Trellin had to have something right here. Now we can see that he actually even has some stuff here. He's going to choose to forego it. And from Hot Meowth's perspective, I would imagine he looks at this and goes, my opponent doesn't have any board clear in hand. Roof Trellin just voluntarily took 7 damage. And Hot Meowth, since he has nothing to develop, life taps here. But I think even if he had something to develop, life tap here would just be fine anyway. Oh, that Solemn Vigil is a big pickup for Roof Trellin right now.
That's very clutch. The exact amount of mana left he needed to be able to play that Vigil. And like you said, Roof Trellin sort of telegraphed that he didn't have board clear, but in fact, he did have both equalities in hand, looking astonished at that Tyrion Ford Ring draw. The second Doomsayer also pretty nice.
Yeah, the rest of the hand is really poor, though, and it's because of the context of that. I mean, the Wild Pyromancer definitely helps this. But his hand has got kind of an awkward curve here. And so if the power of Roof Trellin's cards isn't able to match the pressure that Hot Meowth is applying, this could be really bad news. And just taking a look at the hand, Hot Meowth has a pretty clean answer to this Sylvanas and then pressure to back up after this.
He does, but he does not have a dragon in hand, so that Blackwing Corruptor is not going to be able to be activated. That Alexstrasza's Champion is just a 2-3 minion right now, so has, you know, answers abound, but no dragons at this point in time, so that is potentially going to hold him back a little bit.
Yeah, curious to see where he goes with this.
So and will forego.
Yeah, does go forego some development though. I mean, just having a 5-4 on board is pretty reasonable. But in this situation, Hot Meowth is clearly deciding to value the card economy over necessarily just a better board presence. And I think that's a totally reasonable plan.
I like that. When you're committing to the life tap off of the Finley, you know you're going to be drawing cards. You might as well slip it in wherever you can. And he's had a couple of dead turns in the early game. On turn 4, all he did was life tap. But now he's sort of using it to his advantage. He's dug even deeper into his deck and picked up a dragon where before he would not have had one.
Yep. This is a really interesting turn for a Roof Trellin as well. I mean, playing the Doomsayer here is more of like a healing spell than it is like a board clear spell. Your opponent is very likely to have something to take care of the Doomsayer at this point. But the question he needs to ask is, do I need to Forbidden Healing alongside of this? Because if this gets checked and a Draconid Crusher comes down, that's a threat that he really just can't deal with right now outside of using his second Wild Pyromancer equality.
You know what, I think this is perfectly fine because going into the next several turns, he has 3 aid drops in his hand, all 3 very high value minions. He's definitely going to want to get those down as soon as he can at the opportune moment. So when are you really going to have a chance to Forbidden Healing after this, except maybe on, you know, turn 10? But you have Rag Lightlord at that point, so I like getting it down while you still have a chance.
Yeah, plus the aid drops can just be matched here. I mean, Warrior does an excellent job of tempoing the big drops with executes, and then taking advantage of the fact that their board state went relatively unchecked. It's not a deck that relies on its early game curve. It's a deck that functions way better when it has an early game curve. And so Frothing Berserker going to be the threat of choice for Hot Meowth and expends an execute to allow it some damage push. This is a really interesting play to me, and this is to me spelling that he wants to try to Grom Lethal as quickly as possible.
Yeah, very interesting that he chose to save the executes earlier on and instead used the Core Chronolite to clear off the Doomsayer. In theory, perhaps saving those executes for both of the Ragnaros minions, which we see in Roof Trellin's hand, but now decides to get rid of one. His game plan has definitely shifted a bit to a much more aggressive line of play with that Frothing Berserker.
Yeah, this is like an attack of opportunity where he kind of smells a little bit of blood in the water and goes, wow, the last turn with the Doomsayer, Forbidden Healing, seemed really desperate. Maybe he doesn't have a lot of answers in his hand. He doesn't really have many answers. He just got big things to play.
I mean, that's going to work out for him. He picks up that Draconid Crusher as well as Deathwing, something we haven't seen in every Dragon Warrior deck. I believe in the last match, one of the players only, you know, capped out at Onyxia, and the Deathwing would have come in very handy in one situation. So going to be interesting to see if that actually plays into anything. But Roof Trellin picks up that N'Zoth.
The Light Lord here is fantastic as well. Honestly, this is like a consideration for clear because you just can't really do much in the face of Ragnaros Light Lord like healing you once. I mean, he has to take 7 here. He goes back up to 18. 12. Set. I think he's actually just dead if he plays Ragnaros Lightlord.
Hotmouth has 12 from Grom in hand with that Inner Rage.
That's lethal. And this was set up because of the Frothing Berserker growing.
Wow, so
this
Hot
was just
Meowth.
Perfect for Hotmouth.
That was some incredible foresight from him. It seemed like his game plan in the beginning was going to be a bit of a more grindy match, but then with the life tap, being able to draw all the cards that he really needed at the right time. And you can just tell right now he's counting his points of damage. He wants to make sure he has it.
Yeah, I mean, he's doing the math like probably over and over in his head right now. And yeah, I don't know.
I believe it is exactly
18. He's going through this motion. Yes. He's like, I'm just making sure I'm not crazy. This does put him to 12, right? Yeah, Hot Meowth, capitalizing on the Doomsayer Forbidden Healing was the turn that really decided this for Hot Meowth. You know, had a great opening hand. Roof Trellens was weak with very few options. Mm-hmm. Not a lot of breathing room after that, so just kind of gets pushed out of the game from having too heavy of a hand.
And we actually questioned the inclusion of that Inner Rage in the Dragon Warrior build. We've seen it teched into a couple lists so far, and up until now it hadn't been too useful, but in this case, if Hot Meowth hadn't had the Inner Rage, he would not have had Lethal. It would have given Roof Trellen more time to use that Ragnaros Lightlord to Nazoth for a Tyrion and a Sylvanas. So in this case, Inner Rage really helped him close out that game early on.
Yeah, it's kind of a surprise factor mechanic, but it also happens to function really well when you're playing against the more controlling lineups. Just being able to have Burst at a lower cost of mana means that you can push the action to your opponent that much sooner. You know, if the Paladin stabilizes and gets to turn 10, that's when you're going to have a really tough time closing. And typically you would need Grom plus Blood to Ichor in order to activate it. And a lot of times Grom was just for value in the Dragon Warrior deck as well. But the inclusion of Inner Rage allows it to be a much more aggressive tool when you draw that combination.
Yeah, a lot of the time the Grom would sort of exist as a third core Crown Elite that just happened to live on the board afterwards, but would get immediately removed. But in this case, Grom did its job, and Hot Meowth is going to take game one, going up 1-0 against Roof Trellen's Paladin. Now, how do you think these lineups are going to work with each other after this? Hot Meowth has the Paladin and the Warlock, and Roof Trellen still has all three of his decks left.
Well, the only thing that concerned me was just the speed at which Roof Trellen decks are being played. I mean, the Cabalist Tome Mage deck, fairly slow. Mm-hmm. Nazoth Paladin, it's fairly slow. This is a metagame that I feel like is kind of quick and to the point a lot of times. But he's been having success with it so far. There's been a lot of players succeeding with kind of off-the-wall lineups. He could just have something figured out and just be a victim of his draw that game. I mean, his draw was pretty abysmal, all things considered.
Yeah, looked like it was pretty nice in the start, but didn't get True Silver Champion. A lot of those key cards in the matchup, unfortunately, not coming into his hand. So we are going to go into game two. Hot Meowth playing his Zoo Warlock against Roof Trellen's Yogg Druid. Now, we've actually seen this matchup quite a bit over the last couple of days, and how do you think this is going to fare? Hot Meowth's hand looks pretty good so far.
Yeah, I mean, that's like a pretty close to a dream opener. Versus Druid, the real goal is to get things on board and hope that they don't die so that you can push a lot of damage. Roof Trellen chose to keep a copy of Raven Idol in the opening hand, and I'm curious what he's searching for exactly for this. It does, if you're looking specifically for one of the cards in your deck, keeping it a Raven Idol and looking specifically for that card does have a higher percent chance to draw it than strictly mulliganing for that card on that one slot. So that could be a big consideration here. And it also could just be keeping them to get some options for swing turns like Starfall, Swipe, those sorts of things.
And he does actually pick up a Starfall off the first Raven Idol. You can kind of see him, you know, nod his head. It's not too bad. It's a little bit late, but two damage to the entire board does generally clear off the majority of the Zoo minions. Runs into a problem against the Darkshire Councilman and the Imp Gang boss, but definitely, if you're not going to get swiped, Starfall is certainly a nice, you know, second option to have.
It's like a consolation prize.
Yeah, exactly. But going into turn two, Roof Trellen has no other option but to Raven Idol for the second spell, hoping to pick up a Living Roots. A Wild Growth would have been nice.
It would have been good on the first one.
Yeah.
Typically, Wild Growth isn't like an all-star in this matchup, but it definitely helps. And so kind of the panouts of the Raven Idol, if the discovers were reversed, I think it pans out a lot better for Roof Trellen. But if you look at his hand, he doesn't really have an answer to anything. And this is where the Zoo capitalizes, is when its early damage goes unchecked, it's usually able to start snowballing.
I actually really like how Hot Meowth chose to play his first two turns. He does have the coin in hand, so he could have chosen to go one drop coin, one drop into two drop on two, but that would have left him with, you know, perhaps an inefficient turn three. This way, by just saving that coin, he's able to play Defender of Argus, get the nice value on the Argent Squire, and this It's a board that it is just so difficult for Rift Trellin to deal with.
Not only that, but he just picked up Power Overwhelming as well. So and the Druid of the Claw that Rift Trellin has chosen to run over Ancient War, and mostly because he's got Wisps of the Old Gods in the list. It's just too many 7-drops at that point. This defense is already being checked by what Hot Meowth has in hand. And just, again, kind of illustrating the point of checking the early game being super important.
Yeah, you definitely want a mulligan for those early game removal spells. Living Roots, Wild Growth, of course, Wrath, really, really nice. And then a Swipe, of course, in the matchup because
Innervate's
of the
a big all-star
the
in this matchup
minions.
As well. Just
Absolutely.
Being able to power out a Violet Teacher or a Fandral early on means that it's likely to be able to attack a couple of minions in a row.
Now, what is Rift Trellin's plan going to be? He could potentially Nourish for mana and just try to have a really large swing turn. He does have the Starfall. Maybe picking up some other form of removal could potentially allow him to clear Hot Meowth's board. What do you think he's going for here?
This is the spot where he's got to develop a kind of an alternative game plan. I mean, he didn't check anything early on, and he's going to go for the card draw here. Second Innervate does get picked up alongside a Wrath. And so this is a pretty nice bit of disruption. This was very needed if Rift Trellin's going to get back into this. So this is kind of the starting point. But Hot Meowth's got great card economy with two more Dark Peddlers in his hand. It's just turn after turn, he's applying a lot of pressure. So this will get largely hurt by the Starfall that's in hand, but it's kind of a Band-Aid for now. He's not really getting to the root of the problem here.
No, and Hot Meowth does get some pretty nice discovers. He picks up the Stone Tusk Boar and the Mortal Coil, which is, you know, you'd rather have Power Overwhelming, something like that. But he did choose the Mortal Coil over the Flame Imp, so definitely prioritizing some form of removal, especially against the Token Druid, which does have, you know, quite a few one-health minions.
Yep, and he, kind of being forced into the Innervate on Starfall here as well. The backup for Rift Trellin is really lacking right now. So Sea Giant gets delayed here. Big problem for Hot Meowth, but he's pretty far ahead in terms of where you would normally be in the damage race. And now this is the life tap position. We're going to be life tapping almost every turn for the rest of the game. And Rift Trellin's hand has double Savage Roar, Mulch, Onyxia. This is not the makings of a comeback here.
No, not at all. And Hot Meowth, while the cards in his hand do seem inefficient right now with his mana, he does have that Stone Tusk Boar and that Power Overwhelming, which is actually very relevant. It represents quite a bit of damage from hand if Rift Trellin were to pick up something like a Swipe to be able to clear off the board, maybe even a Wrath for one.
Needs a Swipe here. Instead, it's just Druid of the Claw. And this is the kind of situation where if Hot Meowth didn't have anything at hand to check this, this would be okay. Instead, it's going to be something along the lines of Sea Giant Power Overwhelming. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be really bad news. The mulch is there for the Sea Giant, but just the fact that damage is getting pushed, and once again, not really anything to take care of what's happening. He's right on the verge of recovery. But is he going to have enough time? He's just taken so much damage already.
It's going to be close. He definitely will mulch that Sea Giant. It'll leave an additional 2 damage on Hot Meowth's board, and that Imp Gang boss can be a real problem. We haven't seen a Swipe come into Rift Trellin's hand, and there is the literal game changer coming into Rift Trellin's hand. Everybody's favorite, or not so favorite, Yogg-Saron.
Well, this is a really interesting turn to me. Hot Meowth chose to take one of his 1/1s off the board by using the body from the Possessed Villager, rather than use the Possessed Villager to get an extra 1/1. So now in this spot, he's only got 2 damage. This would have been a spot where a second Power Overwhelming would have won him the game.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, we're looking at Dig the Leroy, but if the Mortal Coil doesn't draw it, it's a life tap, can't draw it. But he gets Master Jouster, which I don't think is winning too often versus
All
the
right.
Druid. But he does have the major presence on board right now. And Rift Trellin, once again, doesn't have an answer. This is just a 5-6 that he can't deal with.
And there is a Swipe coming into Rift Trellin's hand. And this is where it's really important to note that Hot Meowth is not running Doom Guards, but in fact only 1 Leroy. So he does not have 2 outs in his deck. He only has 1.
Yeah, this is a big turn. I'm curious if Rift Trellin ever adds a Savage Roar to this just to up the Yogg count at this point.
I mean, why not? You get to hero power, you gain 1 health. So essentially, you're net neutral on the attack to the 1 drop.
A little bit of damage lost there. He could have put a couple extra points of damage on Hot Meowth's face, just swiping face and Savage Roar with the Violet Teacher attacking and dealing last 5 points of damage.
Yes.
Not too consequential this game. I think it's really going to boil down to whether or not the Knife Juggler either ends at this turn, which I believe it does for the Forbidden Ritual. Yes,
yeah.
This is way more than enough. So
5 to...
Yeah.
He has 5 damage, 2 knives into the apprentices, likely.
Oh, it doesn't
quite
end it, actually.
Well, no, because then it's only 3 to face and 1 damage on board. Yogg-Saron, can you work your magic this time?
Oh, my gosh. Did hop me out that 1 damage? Did that cost him anything, potentially? Oh,
I think it might have. Oh, he's not dead.
I mean, this is it.
My goodness.
Well, the knife juggler's still alive.
Okay.
Wait, Whirlwind clears.
Charge?
Oh my gosh.
No, Polymorph. Oh, Yogg, not this time. Twisting net. Okay.
This is the way that my Yoggs typically look.
Silence.
Okay.
All right.
So, well, stabilizing at 1 is going to be really hard. He got the clear he needed, but at 1 life, it's very difficult to come back. He has to check every minion from Hot Meowth for the rest of the game.
That's going to be pretty much impossible. Rift Trellin doesn't have large taunt minions left, and Hot Meowth can just literally throw minions onto the board, and eventually 1 damage will stick.
Yeah, the situation, just no need to life tap. Just play 3 things. Can Roof Trellin kill 3 things?
Goodness. I mean, it was a fair Yogg. Not quite nearly as explosive as in the last match, but I mean, a little bit too late for Roof Trellin, at least to give him a chance.
Yeah, even if the Feral Rage had restored health here, it still would have been really difficult to come away with it. But it definitely needed a very clutch Yogg there if it was going to pick it up.
Hot Meowth looking visibly relieved after that wild growth comes down, and it's over. Rift Trellin is going to attack into that Darkshire Councilman.
He's found lethal
on himself, which must make Hot Meowth pretty happy, but unfortunately for Rift Trellin, that is going to put him down 0-2 in the series against Hot Meowth's Warlock Zoo. I mean, Yogg-Saron just giving him that little sliver of hope, but sometimes is that almost even worse? You're thinking, man, maybe I have a chance. It might still work out for me, and then just all your hopes dashed once again, and it's just not quite good enough.
Yeah, this one, Roof Trellin might have, once again, kind of been a victim of the way the draw panned out, but did choose to keep a Raven Idol in the opening hand. I mean, Zoo is a matchup where Living Roots is very strong. Mm-hmm. Innervate's very strong. Where having Wrath and just access to damage spells that can kill minions helps you scale to your later portions. He did not have that in the early stages of the game, and as a result, took too much damage. You know, if he'd have been at like 15 or so when that Yogg happened, that'd have been a very realistic and winnable game. But I'm curious if keeping the Raven Idol in that matchup is the right call. Maybe just digging for answers is better.
All right, and we are going to have just a small delay. One of the players has asked to use the restroom. So while we wait to get back into that, let's take another look at these lineups. Hot Meowth left with just his Paladin, any Finn Paladin with 2 Ivory Knights. And Rift Trellin has yet to pick up a win. It's going to be that Druid, the Mage, and his own Paladin, which is N'Zoth. We've seen it already, but we have yet to see that Shifter Xeris. So what do you think Rift Trellin's going to try to bring out? In this case, you want to get that first win. You want to put yourself on the board, give yourself more time to potentially come back and try to turn this match around.
I think the big thing to think about here is how does matchups actually line up against Murloc Paladin? Like, what's the game plan here? I don't have a ton of experience playing with or against Murloc Paladin. It's a deck you rarely see out on the ladder. And so because of that, it's also got the new dynamic with the Ivory Knight in there. A potential third anything can happen. Is this a matchup where you need to be more aggressive? Is this one where you can save as many tools as possible and just try to answer all the anythings can happen and be at a high enough life total? That's a difficult thing to be able to decide unless you have some experience in this matchup. And so that's really the thing I'm looking at Roof Trellin's lineup and wondering. You know, the N'Zoth Paladin's not going to be that aggressive. The Tempo Mage with Cabalist Tome can get some very slow draws in there. I think this is a cause for concern for Roof Trellin at this point.
At this point, it might just come down to experience. Like we'd said before, people playing the Ivory Knight Paladin haven't had a lot of experience testing it. But in that same vein, everybody playing against it hasn't had enough time to test their lineups as well. And do you think people expected to see this much Paladin at the tournament?
Not quite this much. I think it was definitely on some players' radar, but I think this is an exceptional amount that you've seen this week, and a lot of it is influenced by Ivory Knight. So curious to see where it goes. Roof Trellin gonna keep Innervate, of course, in his hand, and that's a pretty decent opener. Would like to find some gas to go along with it. And on Hot Meowth's side, This is an interesting deck to watch. A lot of little things make a big difference when you're playing Murloc Paladin.
So many nuances. And of course, the damage output isn't as much as it used to be when old Murkai was in standard format. But with the addition of that Ivory Knight, you have the potential to, you know, use even more damage from your Bluegill Warriors charge with three anythings, four potentially, plus so much health. But that Wild Growth in Rift Trellin's hand has just, I'm sure, made him a happy guy. That is a great card to draw.
Yeah, especially when you have the turn one Violet Teacher into Wild Growth.
Pay attention, class.
Kind of making the same faces here.
Yeah, definitely. I'm sure they've both been in this situation before on either side of it. Hot Meowth.
Does have a pretty fantastic hand against this for Hot Meowth, though. I mean, having the Equality Wild Pyromancer earlier, even just Consecration, can buy you some very needed time. But this pressure is going to mount very quickly. So those tools, pretty much necessary if he's going to come away with a win in this game.
Mind if I roll me?
Absolutely. He does pick up the Loot Hoarder. That's nice to have. And the Paladin doesn't have a lot of reason to worry about, you know, just a little bit of damage here and there. They do have Forbidden Healing, Rag Light Lord, now Ivory Knight, which also can be a substantial heal. So, you know, three damage is inconsequential at this point. But that,
I'm curious if this is good enough to just go ahead and clear, honestly. I mean, Hot Meowth may just want to wait and see extra resources. The problem is the threat of Nourish from Rift Trellin. And if he waits and Nourish comes out, he's probably going to lose. So Hot Meowth showing that very much respect when he chooses to go with Wild Pyromancer Equality here.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely a perfectly fine board clear. It's only two minions, but it's two very high priority minions. And Hot Meowth, I'm sure, has had a chance to look at Rift Trellin's deck list to see that there aren't too many taunt minions. We've got two Wisps of the Old Gods instead. So yeah, the Equality Pyro here, perfectly fine. Just wants to go ahead and reset that board, put himself in a more favorable position.
And a very weak follow-up from Rift Trellin as well. You know, now I'm worried. Reporting for duty. Are you worried? I'm worried for Rift Trellin.
Man, a 3-0 at this point in the tournament. This is not an elimination match, though. We're still in the winner's bracket, so even if Rift Trellin does lose this match, he goes down into the lower bracket and gets another chance at making the summer championships. But yeah, his hand is just very, very heavy at this point. He's got the Wisps, which is nice, but Hot Meowth has Consecration. He has two Consecrations.
Wow, Ivory Knight looking very strong here. Big heal, nice body, some extra card draw. Now, Rift Trellin does have some potential to try to swing the game here with that Wisps of the Old Gods. And honestly, at this point, I think he's so desperate, this is just the game plan.
Mm-hmm. Try to go for board, hope to draw Savage Roar to get damage, but Hot Meowth, Consecration is a full board clear here, and he can go ahead and follow it up with a Murloc War Leader. He just drew that Acolyte. That's also possible. Basically, anything he wants. Solemn Vigil for free.
Why not?
Also created from that Ivory Knight. So Ivory Knight giving him 5 health, 2 cards, and a 4/4 body for 6 mana.
Which connects. And Murloc War Leader just going to start the pressure here for Hot Meowth. He senses weakness. That seems to be something he's very good at, is sensing those weaknesses.
All right, Emperor Tharizan is not a bad pickup. It does challenge the board. Hot Meowth having to find some way to clear it off. It's a really high priority target. The discounts are not too, you know, important here. Rift Trellin was getting to that mana cost anyway in the game, but Yogg-Saron.
Yeah, it's fairly inconsequential, I'd say, at this point. I mean, it's really going to boil down to whether or not Rift Trellin has answers for what's happening here. I mean, it's very easy check on the Emperor Tharizan here. Hot Meowth adding more to the board to increase card economy. Rift Trellin has to have this Yogg-Saron go good. I mean, he's got a little bit more time. I don't think he has to Yogg right here. But this board isn't something that Onyxia or Wisp of the Old Gods is going to fight that well against.
No, not at all. I think the only consideration here is Wisps of the Old Gods is one more spell. Is that one more spell going to be potentially game-changing on the Yogg? I mean, he hasn't played too many so far. He had a Wild Growth. I believe he had an Innervate in the early hand. Coin does count as well, but yeah, not as many spells nearly as he would like to be seeing on that Yogg.
Yeah, and you can see it in his face. I mean, he realizes it. This is a decider match right here. These are not great spells to pan out either.
Oh,
Well, that's interesting. So that puts the Yogg back in hand. That actually fills up Hot Meow's hand as well.
Oh my goodness, Hot Meow.
Well, that was a great finish to the Yogg. I mean, that's exactly the kind of turn that Roof Trella needed, I think, to get back in this game. Suddenly, he has spells for gas. He has ways to reload the board. He just saved himself a ton of life from reducing the pressure.
That was phenomenal. And Hot Meowth burns a Solemn Vigil. Not too important. He does have an already full hand. He wouldn't want to be drawing too many more cards at this moment in time, but possibly might matter in the later game. And this is actually one of the first times we've seen Ivory Knight be pretty bad, I would have to say. These discover choices are not what you want to see.
Yeah, the humility was interesting, I think, because if Yogg's Run actually sticks, you have a check to it, or if something like Anixia comes out. But he does have Eldor Peacekeeper in hand, so does he need a second humility effect? You know, maybe lacking in pinpoint healing, sort of the concern there. But this is the stage where Hot Meowth, again, he can kind of answer what Roof Trellin's doing, but now we're building to the second Yogg's Run.
And here's another thing. Hot Meowth has the Consecration. He can clear off all of the whelps and then set Onyxia at one attack. But then Roof Trellin has the second Wisps of the Old Gods plus Savage Roar in hand. Is it going to be possible for Roof Trellin to build a third large board of minions and then possibly just Savage Roar for lethal?
Yeah, I mean, that's the first angle of attack, is ideally you get to a safe state. And that's the plan. Try to force answers. Then when your opponent has, hopefully not, but sometimes do manage to answer everything, Yogg's Run's the backup. He's got a second one now.
It's not every day you see two Yogg's Run's in the same game. Usually it's Shadow Step, Vanish. I don't think I've seen quite as much, but this is, I mean, it's better than one Yogg in your game. Two Yogg's. Get lucky twice, why not? But you know what? It was actually a very calculated risk by Roof Trellin playing that first Yogg's Run. He could have waited. We saw him hover over his own Onyxia. We saw him think about the Wisps of the Old Gods. But instead, he thought, I need to make a winning play, and I'm going to go for the Yogg's Run. And it worked out very nicely in his favor.
Yeah, looks like we're nourishing for a few cards here. And alongside Innervate, some real options are presented at this point.
Does have 7 mana to work with.
I'm honestly feeling the Wisp of the Old Gods here.
You are? You like it? I don't know. It doesn't seem like he...
This is gonna Innervate Doomsayer. Oh, this is really smart.
Wow.
I love this play from Roof Trellin. So his goal is to make sure this Doomsayer goes off. And then once initiative is back on his side, use that Wisp of the Old Gods. This is a very keen play from Roof Trellin right here. And I'm not really sure anything can check this.
Hot Meowth does have both copies of Anything Can Happen in his hand, but we've only seen one Murloc War Leader die this game, haven't even seen Bluegills in his hand, so those are essentially useless. Well, then what does he have to work with? He has a Forbidden Healing, which can stall a little bit more. He does have some draw mechanic. Okay, there's the first Bluegill.
Well, that will allow the death of the Druid of the Claw. I imagine he's going to be sending this Bluegill out just so he can start using Anything Can Happen. But I'm sensing some card draw here as well.
Yes, he's going to go ahead and put out the Blood Mage just to draw a card. And here's actually where that Solemn Vigil discard could have made a big difference if he had actually drawn it instead of having to get it destroyed right away because of overdraw.
Yeah, this game, I think, is going to be decided by the next couple of draws here. I mean, Hot Meowth is very weak to a Wisp of the Old Gods coming this turn. Doesn't have the damage to push on Roof Trellin just yet.
I mean, what removal does Hot Meowth have left? He's used one copy of Equality.
It's a second wild
Pyromancer.
Ivory Knights are gone. I see him shaking his head. I mean, if the Druid's board sticks, they can just kill you. And so it's looking like Living Roots instead. So this kind of sets up an identical looking board, except now he's got two board, board-wide buffs to use with Wisp of the Old Gods and with Savage Roar.
It's also essentially saying you can't just have Wild Pyromancer plus Forbidden Healing, for instance, and clear my board outright. You need to have some way to clear off the Mire Keeper and the token as well.
Doesn't pick it up.
Oh, and my goodness.
I mean, this is probably the end here. I mean, even at 30, you're looking at 6 damage on board, and then you get 12 more from the Savage Roar. That's 18 total. You get 10 more from the Wisp of the Old Gods. I mean, he needs to be above 28 to survive this push.
Is he going to have the forethought to actually heal? He does. He plays the Holy Light. And Roof Trellin so close to actually turning this game around and potentially putting himself back in the series.
I mean, this is definitely the turn that Roof Trellin needed. It's been a long-fought road, but all the tokens are a catalyst to the massive damage potential you can unlock from Savage Roar.
What do you think he's going to do? He can go ahead and just put all the damage on the board, hit Hot Meowth for, I believe you said it was 28. He does also have the option to sort of hedge his bets. Savage Roar now, because this is most likely the most tokens you're going to have on board, the most damage potential. Save the Wisps for another large board of 1/1s and just swipe the minions.
You buff and you giddy up and Hot Meowth.
He's going to go for it.
He's on the back foot now. I mean, even in the face of a Forbidden Healing for 20 in this spot, look at how much damage he's still facing down on board. That buff from the Wisps of the Old Gods is permanent.
Oh my goodness. Hot Meowth can put himself back at 22. But how does he possibly deal with this? He has two Forbidden Healings in hand. Anyfin's essentially useless. Doomsayer going to do nothing, and a second True Silver that he won't have time to play.
That's what I'm looking at, where he actually wins. I'm curious, can he ever just push damage here? Don't think so. So second Forbidden Healing, I mean, he does have some more time. So we're still in a bit of a grind battle here.
He only has 4 damage from the Bluegill right now.
Second Savage Roar, I believe, would end. Yeah, we're just going to build here with the Violet Teacher once again. But Hot Meowth's got his back against the wall.
All right, Wild Growth for the draw first. See if potentially you can get that Savage Roar. He's got 12 on board. Power of the Wild.
That'll do it. That's 20 damage.
Pretty good. All right, and Rooftrellin on the back of a Yogg-Saron final card vanish, was able to take back this board, stabilize, and we've got a match now, Admirable.
Yeah, this is another kind of cause of concern, again, on the Murloc Paladin side, is when you don't draw your Murlocs, your Anyfins are just, they're dead cards. Mm-hmm. And in that situation, he couldn't find the damage for it. He checked the early game very well. And granted, he had to use the Wild Pyromancer quality way sooner than he wanted to, but that's the kind of situation Druid can put you in on the back of Innervate. And so this game was really kind of a product of Hot Meowth not having the amount of cycle necessary to find the full combo. And of course, the Yogg-Saron mm-hmm. giving the clear that was necessary, and then a full recovery afterwards.
I mean, when you're facing down a Fandral and a Violet Teacher on turn 4, really Wild Pyromancer equality is your only option, and it doesn't feel too bad, but the potential for the Token Druid to spawn so many large boards that you just absolutely have to deal with, because the addition of a Savage Roar can quickly turn what only looks like a 7 damage board knowledge into lethal very fast.
Yeah, that the only thing I would consider in that spot is, how badly does Nourish hurt you, and how often does your opponent have Nourish in that spot? Because outside of Nourish, everything else could be checked by the Wild Pyromancer equality. Mm-hmm. So is taking the damage there and trying to get some more card expenditure from Rooftrellin a better game plan than outright checking it that turn?
Yeah, at that point, you're not worried about Living Roots, you're not worried about Power of the Wild, because everything is just outright destroyed by that Pyro equality. But he was worried enough about Nourish, he thought that if Rooftrellin had the Nourish, then it would have just, you know, it would have meant game over from turn 4.
Fandral definitely provides a lot of fear value.
Yeah, for certain. But we're going to go into game number 4. Rooftrellin will be bringing his Tempo Mage, which does have 2 copies of Cabalist's Tome in it, up against Hot Meowth's Murloc Paladin once again. And this time, Hot Meowth does get a Murloc in his opening hand, which is pretty important in this matchup, as well as a Doomsayer, which is really, really nice to have to put these Mana Worms in check.
Yeah, Doomsayer is a very critical card. Facing down a single minion at a time buys you tempo back, able to alleviate some pressure. And the Bluegill Warrior is important because of Cult Sorcerer and Sorcerer's Apprentice. Those are two sort of the difficult minions to deal with from the Paladin's perspective. And if they don't check that early on, it can become kind of nightmarish. Hot Meowth's going to choose to coin the Doomsayer here. And I think this will be enough to disrupt the Mana Worm.
The question, does Rooftrellin value his Mana Worm so highly that he's willing to try and clear off this Doomsayer with the Arcane Missiles and the Arcane Blast? He's got 2 from the Blast. The Missiles would put his Mana Worm at 3. Hmm. He would have to hit a couple of those Missiles onto the Doomsayer, so it is not a guaranteed clear.
Yeah, but it's about 50%, I believe.
All right, what's he going to go with? Do you throw away the Mana Worm? Nope, he's going to try and hit it.
Well, you know what? It's the best non-hit the Doomsayer result.
That's true. That is true. At least in this case, you get the 3 damage, but Like we said before, those little bits of damage here and there against the Paladin, Paladin doesn't have to worry about that. It has so much healing over time.
Right. It's sort of inconsequential to take tiny amounts at a time unless you're continuing the pressure. And this hand from Roof Trellin is incredibly bad.
But you know what? It is definitely smart that he chose to play the missiles before the Arcane Blast, because in this case, if he had sequenced that incorrectly, he would have just essentially thrown away his Arcane Blast for nothing. So yeah, at least he sort of hedged his bets there by going with the missiles first instead. Double Cabalist Tome in hand.
Well, it's honestly not too bad, but it's pretty bad. I mean, a lot of times the mage kind of wants to run away with the amount of pressure they can apply. Mm-hmm. And that was the reason Roof Trellin went for that risk on turn one. If that succeeds, he's got a 3-3 mana worm on board, and it's likely to get in a significant amount of damage rolling into the rest of his card economy. I think the risk is justified. And now that we're at this stage, it's going to be a matter of can Hot Meowth pressure Roof Trellin, or is Cabalist Tome Azure Drake going to try to take over this game?
Really nice from Hot Meowth, putting out that True Silver on turn four, knowing that going into turn five on Roof Trellin's side, Azure Drake is the most likely minion to be played, and pushes four damage from the Bluegill. Roof Trellin, not a great Cabalist Tome.
Polymorph's really important to draw, and that takes away one of the Murlocs that Anyfin can get back at this point. That Murloc didn't die, it's transformed into the sheep. So anything can happen right now will not summon a Murloc War Leader.
That is actually very, very relevant in this matchup. The Polymorph, not usually something that you include in the Tempo Mage, but Roof Trellin has just included one copy of it, and in this case, it worked out incredibly well.
Yeah, I mean, now it's suddenly, Roof Trellin's kind of transitioned into a weird kind of control deck. And I think this is actually going to work out for him.
I guess the unseen power of Cabalist's Tome, it really is giving him the staying power that he needs. He has the Drake still, which very important spell damage. And Hot Meowth is going for the long game, but if Roof Trellin can sort of match him at every step of the way, it is possible that he can win this game.
Yeah, the problem here is going to be just kind of the lack of healing. And the fact that Hot Meowth has a lot of damage represented with True Silver Champion. And honestly, anything can happen just for four damage is starting to become a threat because Roof Trellin's down to 15. So something needs to give here over the next few turns. And Mirror Image is a fantastic pickup, but not at the moment. Effigy sitting down will want to have that activated first and follow up with Mirror Image to shut down the second attack from that True Silver.
Yeah, Roof Trellin is certainly hoping that Hot Meowth is going to run the True Silver into the Azure Drake. Effigy will proc, giving him another 5 drop, which with Firelands Portal, we've seen some really game-changing 5 drop potential. Earth Elemental, Psychotron would even be, you know, pretty nice in this case. So definitely a lot of potential there. But also that second Cabalist Tome. He could get potentially an Ice Block, an Ice Barrier, something of that sort. A counter spell?
Could find that Firelands Portal that is currently not in his build.
There you go. I mean, why play Firelands Portal when you can play Cabalist Tome and get 3 Firelands Portals?
Or a Cabalist Tome and a Firelands Portal and continue to get Cabalist Tomes.
The value is incredible, Admirable. I think we're all just a little bit behind the times.
Trellin, it's awfully quick paced at this point, but Arcane Blast, not too valuable in this matchup. There's not really too many targets to hit. It's mostly just little tiny utility stuff. And so trying to mount an assault at any step of the way. And this is a situation where Hot Meowth, I think, is really fearing playing the Ragnaros Light Lord at the moment. It's just not a very strong play.
Yeah, and Roof Trellin's definitely, he's building up a board that looks scary, but in actuality, there's only 5 damage represented here, but he did bait out Hot Meowth one of his copies of Wild Pyromancer plus quality, so I think that definitely worked out for him. He chose not to play one copy of the Sorcerer's Apprentice last turn, and instead decided to save them.
This Cabalist Tome could go crazy.
Oh my goodness. Does he choose to play both? He does.
I definitely would. If you get a second Cabalist Tome here, that's castable as well.
There's the Firelands Portal, Admirable. Strictly better here.
Spellbender, not so much. But here's the thing about it. Hot Meowth is never going to activate that Spellbender. He doesn't have spells that really target stuff outside of potentially Humility. So if that doesn't ever pop, Hot Meowth is going to interpret that as an Ice Block.
That is true. That could actually just be a really nice ability for some mind games here. There is the potential that Hot Meowth plays the Ivory Knight and gets something that does target, but yeah, I mean, for Riftrellen, that could be pretty nice.
Honestly, this is getting a little dangerous for Hot Meowth at this point. I mean, Riftrellen has a lot of gas in the tank.
Wow, all right, so Firelands Portal, you definitely clear off this Light Lord. I mean, there's no question about it. And it combos really nicely with the Sorcerer's Apprentice. Another Faceless Manipulator. I was telling you yesterday, I always seem to get Ram Wrangler and Faceless Manipulator for my five drops.
They're about the worst you could get.
Does feel pretty bad, but he's managed to take this board back.
This is a big Yogg at this point, too. We've seen a ton of spells.
I mean, two Cabalist Tome, he's played six spells from them. That's eight right there. Mirror Image, Arcane Missiles, Arcane Blast. This Yogg will be pretty big.
Hot Meowth needs to find... He needs to find the rest of his Murlocs, honestly.
Mm-hmm. Ivory Knight could give him something like a Solemn Vigil, draw him a couple cards, get into those Murlocs.
Just look at Hot Meowth. He looks nervous right now.
Oh, my goodness.
The Yoggs are on. I mean, this could go either way.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
Oh, that's bad. That's good.
An Archmage Antonitis gets drawn. And this is definitely a win condition for Riftrellen right now.
Okay.
I can definitely tell you that Yogg-Saron wins that little fight.
Nice. Much needed life. Free health.
Discards. Oh, that's never the one you want to see.
Right before the Shadow Step and the charge. That's so unfortunate.
Yeah.
Oh, but he does pick up that ice barrier.
Well, not like the strongest Yogg in the world, but did get some life, some secrets, and a couple of extra cards off of it. So I feel like Yogg kind of did its job here. And now the win condition for Riftrellen is finding spells to combo with Archmage Antonitis. And with an Emperor Thorson and an Arcane Blast in hand, if a spell on the cheap gets picked up here, you could be seeing some fireworks. Instead, it's Mana Worm. And we're in the slow things down state again.
Hot Meowth picks up the Enter the Colosseum off of his Ivory Knight, potentially. I mean, it did gain him the most health by far. The others were just one-drop choices. But how good do you actually think the Enter the Colosseum will be in this matchup?
Well, it's kind of tough here, honestly. He can't kill the Emperor Thorson without using an Anything Can Happen right now. He could go for Aldor Peacekeeper and another Colosseum. I believe it's 50-50 if the minions are tied in power.
Yes.
But that's a lot to use to try to kill an Emperor Thorson right now.
He's going to Ivory Knight first and try to find something
no.
else.
Okay. I was about to say, he's if the Blessing of Kings, there's a Spellbender on Riftrellen's side right now.
That could have been huge. The Holy Wrath will actually target the Spellbender as well.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. But if he had picked up the Blessing of Kings, played it, and cleared off that Emperor, wow.
A big thing here, too, is that Riftrellen's going to get a second activation of Emperor. So I'm thinking like Arcane Intellect is probably just the best draw at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Competitive Spirit. All right. There's a Fireball.
Well, Fireball's not bad either. This is suddenly we have chained together a couple Fireballs here.
You go ahead and Fireball, Arcane Blast. You get two more Fireballs in hand, which get discounted to three each from the Tharizon at the end of the turn.
Yeah, this is a slowdown kind of spot for Riftrellen. There's a lot of things that can happen here. And I'm glad he sort of paced himself, because sticking Archmage to the board is almost going to outright end the game. And so not hastily playing it is very important. Not only that, but now we're looking at the five cost Archmage Antonitis.
And Riftrellen actually chose to clear off the three attack minion there instead of the Ivory Knight, which does challenge his Flame Waker. Do you think maybe that was just a bit of an oversight?
I think maybe he wants to get the Flame Waker attacked instead of the Emperor. It could have just been an oversight at this point. That's what I'm going to guess ends up happening. Is, you know, he played that turn fairly quickly, I'd say, relative to the decisions available. Second, anything can happen, but we're still lacking Murlocs.
You know what? A big choice behind that Holy Wrath might have simply been the cycle.
I believe it
was. He needs those other cards. He needs to find that second Bluegill. He has no War Leaders currently that have been killed, because the only War Leader he's drawn was Polymorphed. So Riftrellen
He's got another problem on his hands as well, which is an unchecked Archmage Antonitis right now. No board presence, nothing in hand to currently answer it.
Archmage Antonitis has been steadily phased out of the Tempo Mage decks, but in this case, it's the win condition that Ruf Trellin needed after the Yogg was already gone.
And look at Hot Meow. I mean, he started the series up 2-0.
My goodness, and we've been saying so many great things about this Murloc Paladin so far. There's been a surprising amount of them in the tournament, a surprising amount of them that have made it to the second day, and Hot Meow is just struggling to find a win with it in this case.
I mean, this is such an important match. I mean, you're one game away from securing a championship spot, and suddenly your opponent is Archmage Antonitis comboing you.
Oh my goodness. Hot Meow tries to play the humility on the Archmage, just desperately wanting to cut down that damage a little bit, but the Spellbender, which in this case allowed Ruf Trellin to keep 4 more damage on board. Not entirely a bad outcome for him.
These are 7 power fireballs being launched right now. Is that 11? I mean, he has to pick up something right now or we're going to game 5.
But what can it possibly be? You can Holy Wrath and hope. Yeah, you hit with the Acolyte first, try to draw. Okay, well, there's Consecration. If Holy Wrath can give him...
Has to succeed.
A 5 drop.
Oh, that's not a good sign either.
Oh, he's 1 mana off. He's so close to being able to clear this board, but in that case, his last Murloc was the final card in his deck, and we saw that War Leader coming into his hand, but just too little too late for Hot Meowth. And Ruf Trellin has tied up this series on the back of some really, really strong play and some incredible Yogg-Saron.
Almost every single one of the games that we've seen from Murloc Paladin as well, when have they had time to cast Anything Can Happen? I mean, we haven't seen it, I don't think. Like, there's a couple situations where, yes, it has delivered lethal, mm-hmm. and just situations where they've gotten full control. Hot Meow struggling to get control, and that was a pretty slow opening hand from Ruf Trellin in that match. And so I think at this point, he's kind of identified where he needs to go with this. Take it slow, build a giant kind of hand with just a lot of things to do, and try to find combos that put Hot Meow in uncomfortable positions.
And Hot Meowth has actually requested a short 1-minute break. So in that time, we've been talking about how the Ivory Knight has been giving the Paladin the potential to play 3 of those Anything Can Happens. But if you never draw the Murlocs, the first 2 are dead. The third is simply a 10 health heal, which is nice. But then a third dead card in the matchup, I mean, just been really, really difficult for him at this point. Hot Meowth just struggling to even draw correctly, and it's always seemed like in the first couple of turns he's had a nice hand, he's stabilized, he's had those Doomsayers early on, but just unable to draw the Murlocs, which is really unfortunate for him.
Yeah, the only thing to note is that he's using a lot of his resources very aggressively, and there are situations where I'm curious if a more conservative approach has merit. That's really kind of the whole thing of the game, is being able to look at one turn and see where the rest of the game goes based on your decision. It's hard to pick one or the other and then also figure out which one's better than the other options. It's a difficult deck to play, and it's something that I'm always concerned with, is that do you have enough practice and experience in this? You know, I'm guessing he doesn't have too much practice versus Tempo Mage mm-hmm. with Cabalist Tome, and now we're moving into the Zoth Paladin matchup, which for all intents and purposes has been a very low profile deck since the very early stages of the Whispers of the Old Gods meta. So this is the matchup I think that Hot Meowth is probably the most favored in amongst mm-hmm. these three. But
does he have the experience?
Right. And navigating this matchup quite literally boils down to finding the turn to use Anything Can Happen, which that's basically up to whether or not Ruf Trellin has a strong curve. I mean, can you think of another situation that Ruf Trellin put together for a win other than just a very strong curve?
This is definitely a matchup where patience is key. And like you've been saying, Hot Meowth has maybe not been taking the time to find all of his potential lines of play, maybe been a little bit impulsive, a little bit too quick in some of his decision making. So in this case, he's really going to have to take his time. And there is so much on the line for this match. You don't want to, you know, potentially, you know, miss out on a better play just because your nerves are kicking in, just because of the stakes that are, you know, on the line here.
Yeah, it looks like he's kind of got that in control. I don't want to say that he has been impulsive, but I feel like he could be using a little bit more of his mm-hmm. time to really think through some of these situations, because a lot is going on when you make a choice on a particular turn when you have lots of things that are happening. Like when he had two True Silvers, for instance, mm-hmm. and he had the Anyfin Can Happen, and only thing that had died was the Bluegill Warriors. Mage doesn't have a way to heal outside of like Ice Barrier from Cabalist Tome. Is there any merit to just pushing damage and putting a Root Trail into the test? You have to be above the health of 8 when I have a True Silver and an Anyfin going into turn 10. That, I think that's a possibility.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well,
Shifter's Heiress.
It's all come down to game 5, and there is the Shifter's Heiress, a golden Shifter's Heiress at that.
If you're going to bring it in style. Roof Challenge decides to keep a Doomsayer and a Solemn Vigil in his opening hand. So the Doomsayer, I believe, is a nod to an early Murloc Warleader or an Acolyte of Pain, just being able to try to check those without your opponent getting significant value from them. And the Solemn Vigils are very important in this matchup because I think Roof Challenge understands he needs to find big threats and have the threats go pretty much unchecked.
Roof Trellin snap keeping that Shifter's Heiress. It does say it's a one drop, but it is not in fact a one drop. It will transform every turn, but the longer you do have it in hand, the more potential you have to find a minion that will be useful at that point in the game. So I think in this case, he's keeping it to hedge his bets and hopefully give him the best potential of finding a useful minion
challenger
from it.
If you're gonna play Shifter's Heiress, you better keep it on turn one.
Not likely you're going to draw it on turn 8 and it's just going to happen to be Ragnaros. And you're going to think, oh, that's pretty good.
Needs a turn to convert. Hotmeowth. I'll tell you what. Hotmeowth does look stressed, though. Roof Challenge kind of looked the same the entire match. Just playing cards.
Let
but
me think.
With Hotmeowth, I mean, this, you can tell that the significance of the match is really mm-hmm. starting to occur to him. I mean, he started out 2-0. Everything looked fine. Now you've lost two straight with Murloc Paladin.
Yeah, at this point, you just really need to, you know, take as much time as you can, really clear your head, get yourself back into this game. Morale is a huge factor in you know, competitive Hearthstone, in matches that are this important. Ravenholt Assassin, not...
I just want to see what happens with Shifter's Heiress every
I'm so excited. I mean, Yogg-Saron, yeah, it's cool. Crazy things can happen, but when do you get to see a Shifter's Heiress potential?
Yes, I mean, 6-0 did have it in his lineup. At the EU prelims,
mm-hmm.
but that's about it. I think it's like the only place that I've seen it in tournament play.
Hotmeowth does have two of his Murlocs in hand this game, which is good. That's more than he can say for some of the last couple of games. That Anyfin in the opener, however, not what you want to see. Acolytes are pretty good. Desert Camel. No one drops in the list, unfortunately. Can't get Desert Camel value here.
Yep, this Bluegill Warrior is likely to grow as well. Roof Challenge, I think this is the kind of situation that Doomsayer is reserved for. Like, is it worth playing here?
Should I?
And I think it is. It's very likely that if Hotmeowth's playing this on turn 2, that he's got Murloc Warleader on turn 3. Mm-hmm. And so denying that is a real possibility. Instead, we're going to forego the Doomsayer, which now is very unlikely to ever activate at a realistic point in this game. And Hotmeowth, he's pained over this. And I think that after last game, that is what part of the break was, is I need to slow down.
Mm-hmm. Just need a minute to collect his thoughts and really
figure
get
it out. Like, yeah. Figure out what the best play is. Hotmeowth has shown an exceptional amount of understanding. And at this point, it's time to really exercise that. This is one of the biggest games he's ever played.
Absolutely. I mean, the winner of this match does get a direct seed into the America's Summer Championship, which will be taking place next month. Every match you guys are seeing today is a decider match, but the loser of this match is not yet out of the tournament. They will move into the lower bracket and have one more chance at making the championship as well. So there is certainly a lot on the line for Hotmeowth, but even if this doesn't work out for him, he will still have one more chance to maybe collect himself and try to figure out what went wrong. But he still could just win this match. So definitely remains to be seen. Riff Trellin.
Interesting use of the coin there.
Mm-hmm.
I could have definitely seen a Doomsayer this turn, and maybe Roof Trellin has sort of a game plan here. I'm guessing that the game plan maybe just be like, once the board's cleared, opponent plays Ivory Knight, you play Doomsayer, try to buy some more late game tempo with it. That's definitely an interesting thought, or even just using it to try to secure a stronger turn later on. But right away, great spot from Hotmeowth. This is this is quite literally True Silver Champion or bust for Roof Trial in this spot, or that Acolyte Pin's going to draw some cards. And so the Doomsayer does mitigate it to one card draw, but a lot of times Acolyte drawing cards in this matchup is kind of where Hot Meowth can get the ball rolling.
That Dragonkin Sorcerer was also playable. Potentially was an option for Rift Trellin, but in this case, you've got the Doomsayer and you really want to get some form of value with it. So it's best just to limit the Acolyte of Pain at one draw instead of the two that it would have gotten.
It's in for a very long matchup here too. So finding just an opportunity for the minion to fit the bill is super important. You know, playing the Dragonkin Sorcerer there, say it runs into Aldor Peacekeeper. Suddenly, it's looking like a liability in the face of that Acolyte of Pain. So it's best to be patient with that card until just the right moment.
Rift Trellin does pick up that Stampeding Coda, which could definitely make a big difference against that second Acolyte from Hot Meowth or either of the Doomsayers in his hand. So important to note that Doomsayer does go off on your turn, allowing Solemn Vigil to be discounted for you, which is actually a very big deal because now instead of what would have been a pretty dead turn, Rift Trellin is able to draw four cards.
Yep, nine cards in the grip. And he's looking like he's got the makings of a curve. I mean, it's starting.
I can see something emerging here. That Twilight Guardian, unfortunately, not going to be a part of it next turn. But that Karen Bloodhoof will also probably not be played because of Doomsayer. But hey.
I don't think it's like too bad to play in Doomsayer. You do still get a 4-5 body out of it. But yeah, I think playing it, honestly, is better than not playing it.
I mean, at this point, what else would you do in the turn? You could play True Silver and just leave it. Jeweled Scarab for a 3-drop.
I can't think of a 3-drop he really wants.
Monster for battle. Oh, wait.
Yep. Like the can here, sacrifice the front half of the body, but you get to play a 4-5 even in the face of an activating Doomsayer. And with Nazoth in the build, not a big loss. Karen is really of staying power more than it is of a really significant threat.
Yeah, more importantly here, you want it to be cleared off. Hot Meowth doesn't have a lot of offensive minions outside of, you know, when he plays anything can happen and gets those Murlocs together. So if you'd played the Karen, it might have been difficult to actually get the Death Rattle activated. So in this case, put it out there, 6 mana for a 4-5 that will then be brought back with the Nazoth. Not too bad.
Now on Hot Meowth's side, this is, pressure is really mounting. Mm. This hand is not so fantastic at the moment.
But what else could he really have? I mean, you're drawing into more removal, more heal, and then you've got two more Murlocs in your deck. That's really all that the deck has.
I think the Doomsayer player is right. Try to snag tempo back.
Fortunately,
it's looking like it might occur here.
Jungle Moonkin. Okay.
Yeah, not a lot of cheap damage spells in the Paladin deck. Not really known for that. And so it looks like that Doomsayer could potentially bite the dust here. I mean, with 10 cards in hand, Roof Trellin's got a wealth of options.
Mm-hmm. All right, and he is just going to go ahead and clear it off in the most direct way with that True
Slow
Silver
grind
Champion.
Has begun.
Yeah, we're playing a long game, Admirable. Hope you're not too hungry.
So, Hot Meowth, once again, looking for the Murlocs and the second Anything Can Happen, I think, are the big deal he's looking for. If he manages to get all four dead and then has both Anythings, that's really his major win condition.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be hard to get significant damage on Roof Trellin. Just, you know, the nature of the matchup, very slow, him having a lot of control elements, a lot of healing spells. It's got to be done over the course of one or two turns.
What is Hot Meowth going to do? He has his head isn't in his hands as he's thinking very hard about what his best line of play is here. Without those Murlocs, it's just a stall game. And this isn't a board that you feel too threatened by. But playing the Ivory Knight just gets removed by the True Silver Champion. So what are his real options?
I mean, everything is just a variable here. Every single variable he draws, Hot Meowth slowing himself down and trying to think about the situation more in depth. That's the important part to me, is that he's taking his time and trying to figure this out. It's a pretty great draw from him.
Yeah, very nice.
Slams the Acolyte. So I'm guessing that Hot Meowth is a little bit desperate for draws at this point. I think trying to maybe find a way to couple Wild Pyromancer with a Consecrate, just keep digging, that would be important. Kodo going to shut down that card draw. The resources are starting to be restricted for Hot Meowth.
That plays the Acolyte in desperation, knowing that with the True Silver Champion on Riftrellen inside, it would be cleared off. He would only draw one card, but Riftrellen able to deny him even that with the Stampeding Kodo. And we see a second one in his hand as well.
We're looking for anything here.
Oh, dear. I mean, do you go for the really long game and get another Forbidden Healing? No, he decides to go with the Enter the Colosseum, which would actually be very useful after the Nuzoth.
Yeah, it's got to find the right situation for it. Very difficult card to use, but Ivory Knight really presenting him with no reasonable options. Hey, there's a Paladin card.
You know, it's almost like you put it in the deck.
He did.
But now you have three of them. Pretty good.
Yeah, we're going for getting a little bit aggressive here, and I think this is exactly where Riftrellen needs to be. It's not a full launched assault. He doesn't have to use all of his resources to do this. It's just piece by piece, he continues to put pressure on Hot Meowth. And just look at the card difference in hand. Hot Meowth's been almost choked out of cards at this point. Very welcomed pickup. And Riftrellen has a wealth of options still.
Enter the Colosseum, pretty useless here for Hot Meowth. Ragnaros would survive. He does have the Pyro Equality or the Equality Consecration, but if he chooses to use that Equality, then Riftrellen is able to build back up another board, and Hot Meowth, the only answer he'll have will be the Enter the Colosseum. So
Ragnaros does need to be dealt with. It's a very high-profile threat in this spot because the damage continues to churn out turn after turn. With something like Tyrion, it can be Aldored, it can get Humilitied.
Yes.
You can check a lot of the damage from Tyrion in the meantime. Ragnaros, you can't do that. It needs to die, or you need to have lots of minions for it to hit. As you might have guessed, Morlock Paladin doesn't have a ton of those in the build. So, pretty standard clear into the dig from Solemn Vigil, and chaining Solemn Vigils here would be great. Instead, we find just a couple more answers. So. Still in fine shape, I think, though.
We're playing Bog Creeper Paladin Admirable.
You can ban Riftrellen Shaman with that Bog Creeper in it. He's going to find a way to play Bog Creeper anyway.
That might have been the exact reason you play Shifter's Aris. He knew the Shaman was going to be banned. He really wanted to play big taunt minions. Put a Shifter in the Paladin. Play the Bog Creeper. You could have also just put the Bog Creeper in the deck, but
no, that's unreasonable.
That's unreasonable.
Why include the card you want to use when you could just use a card that can sometimes be that?
Because it, you know, what if it's something from another class?
Way cooler is why.
What if it's like Savannah Hyman? That's pretty good.
Period.
There you go. But Hot Meowth does have the Alder Peacekeeper to put that Bog Creeper quickly in check. But you know what? Now it just kills off those Silverhand recruits. It's not terrible for Riftrellen.
It's just a slow game, honestly. Both players looking for the spot to turn
Let
the corner.
Me think.
Hot Meowth is just, I think it's one or two cards away at this point. The second Bluegill Warrior would be a great draw.
Yes.
And the other Anyfin would be a great draw. And that's the rest of his draws are kind of just to hope to buy him enough time to get to those points.
And you know, that does actually kind of put Riftrellen on a clock, because until he's able to amount a big enough board state, he's not going to be able to finish off Hot Meowth, and as soon as Hot Meowth draws the cards that he needs, which are coming up pretty soon as the deck thins out, he will be able to mount a lot of pressure and put a lot of damage on Riftrellen.
Yeah. Not only that, but Riftrellen, if he finds more board clears, that is definitely a way to win, too. If he doesn't get bursted in one turn, clearing the board off is a very easy way to win, and so that's been building constantly throughout the course of this game. It's just over and over again, finding ways to put pressure on the board and keep his opponent's minions in check. The 1-8 taunt also is a big deal here. If Hot Meowth doesn't find it, anything can happen off this Ivory Knight, it's possible the damage push could just be unrealistic.
We did just get word that there is 11 cards left in Hot Meowth's deck, so that is more than we were accounting for originally. That is still a lot of variable, but that Solemn Vigil going to be really key in helping him dig through the remaining cards in his deck. One Bluegill Warrior left, one Anyfin can happen left, and that Ivory Knight not picking up another Anyfin, which I'm sure he would have liked, But the Solemn Vigil is at least another way to try to get to his second one.
Right. If you're not going to get one of those cards outright, find something to dig for them. Mm-hmm. And the rest of his hand at this point is, it's pretty dead. I think this is relegated to passing the turn.
Quickly.
Oh, man. That can never feel good, but that 1-8 Bog Creeper taunt is really, really applicable here. I mean, if Hot Meow did have that second Anyfin, could just go for the first one and would be missing out on that precious Anyfin damage because of a silly taunt minion that came from a Shifter Xeris, of all things.
Well, I'm hoping we didn't find a disconnect here. That would definitely be the worst-case scenario.
That would be absolutely horrible in this state of the game. All that Hot Meow really could have done after that was to Hero Power, so not incredibly detrimental, but hopefully he will reconnect if the disconnect was, in fact, what happened.
So, I mean, you know, if the camera's frozen, if he doesn't come back here, this is not looking good.
Oh, no, and it does look like we do have a disconnect on our hands from Hot Meowth. Admirable, that game still potentially could have gone to either player. Rift Trellin was certainly on a clock, but Hot Meowth was as well.
Yeah, right.
And that Bog Creeper standing in the way of the first Anyfin can happen. It's just, wow, that's very unfortunate, especially at this stage in the tournament. The winner of that game had booked their ticket to the championship.
I mean, it's a huge one to have that happen. And admins are working right now to get full information and find the right ruling for this one. So in the meantime, just kind of looking at the way the matchup pans out. Once again, I mean, it looks like Roof Trellin understood exactly what needed to happen there, which is just the slow and steady build. Play threats one by one. Don't try to just build a giant board. Go piece by piece and enforce answers from Hot Meowth. And he did that pretty fantastically. I mean, a lot got forced out of Hot Meowth in that game, and there's still plenty more to go afterwards. We're still looking at Tyrion was there. We hadn't even seen Ragnaros Lightlord played at that point. Mm-hmm. He landed a Kodo on an Acolyte that hadn't drawn a card yet. Those are very big factors in that matchup in particular. And while it's still a long way to go, I mean, it looked to me like Roof Trellin had a significant advantage. Just the fact that there's so much going on. And you look at the first Anyfin can happen with both of the Murloc War Leaders dead.
Mm-hmm.
So both Bluegill Warriors would come back. Let's just say that that's the situation. That's 12 damage burst that happens. On the next one, you're looking at another big burst, but it's not quite a 30 damage burst. If that gets checked by Roof Trellin in that spot and the board gets cleared and he has one turn to cast a Forbidden Healing, he's basically recovered the entire board state at that point. And he found a situation where that was very relevant, again, by forcing answers out of Hot Meowth, being at a safe life total, keeping the pressure going. He had tools in his hand for the first clear. Would have had to see about the second one, but that was looking like Roof Trellin was building to the win.
It definitely, Roof Trellin managed his resources very well, and we are currently determining if that is going to be a regame, just exactly what the ruling will be on that. So hang tight, guys. But, I mean, Roof Trellin really, like you said, had great economy of cards. His hand was always very full, and he managed to limit Hot Meowth with the Kodo on the Acolyte of Pain, just at every step of the way, making sure that he limited Hot Meowth's resources while expanding his own, which is what you need to do in that matchup if you want to have both answers to their board and at the same time put pressure on the board, which is what the N'Zoth Paladin is definitely better at than the Murloc Paladin. The Murlocs usually don't have a lot of that available minion pressure and a great board state to put damage on. It's just very reliant on the Murlocs. And if you don't draw those Murlocs, which we've seen happen for Hot Meowth several times now, it's really unfortunate. You just don't have that pressure.
Yep. To me, something else that's really cool about this matchup is how fitting it is that it's coming down to game five in a Paladin versus Paladin in different Paladin builds. They both had very similar roads to get here. They're both 12-4 in games. They both have won two games in a row in this set. It's just like nothing else could be better about this matchup than this situation. We did get official ruling. It will be a regame. So game number five of Paladin versus Paladin is going to be replayed in this one. So as soon as that game is up and ready and players are ready to get into another battle, looking at another potentially very long game. It's just the nature of the slow combo versus slow control decks.
Is there anything that you think Hot Meowth could do differently this time around to maybe put himself in a better situation. It just seemed like Ruftrellin drew fairly well and then played also very well, and it was almost easy for him. I mean, do you think his deck is just favored, or is there something that Hotmouth could have done differently?
Well, kind of looking at the matchup again, it looks like that Ivory Knight's pulling and anything can happen is a significant difference, I think, in the matchup. And after everything was said and done, Ruftrellin, he kind of has answers to everything, except a third anything can happen. Mm-hmm. That's one's very likely to end, I think, pretty poorly for you. But outside of that, I'm not really sure how Hotmouth could have done anything differently in that game that makes a huge difference. Maybe holding off on the Acolyte of Pain, trying to get it coupled with Wild Pyromancer. Mm-hmm. That could have been an extra card draw for him. Maybe an extra two card draw. You know, trying to slam Acolyte alongside a Silverhand Recruit to make sure to cut into the Kodo value. That mm-hmm. was really the only thing I saw that stood out to me, was how quickly the Acolyte of Pain got played without generating any immediate value.
It is important to note that there are quite a few variables in either player's deck. Hotmouth with both Ivory Knights and then Ruftrellin, he does have two Ivory Knights as well, plus that Shifter Xeris, which if the game had gone to conclusion could have made a real significant difference because of that 1/8 taunt on board that Hotmouth just could not clear at that point. So, I mean, do you think there's always potential that the Shifter Xeris comes into play once again, but how about, you know, Ruftrellin's Ivory Knights? Are they also able to perhaps give him some spells that could counter that third anything?
Well, looking for the extra quality clears, I think, is a big one. The hard part is going to be to clear the board and then heal up outside of range of the third anything can happen. That's really the major road hump he has to get over, is he can clear the first anything, he can clear the second anything. Can he be out of range of the third anything? That's mm-hmm. where things can get really tough. I mean, the situation that can go really poorly there is if the third anything makes six Murloc War Leaders and then one Bluegill Warrior, because
yes.
then you only have a 2+12 burst happening, so you have 14 points of damage off that one. That's a very unlikely mm-hmm. Thing to occur, but being outside of the range of 14 after, like, a second Wild Pyromancer with a quality and then a Forbidden Healing match alongside of that, yes, you can live through a third anything can happen, but then you also have to clear that third anything can
yes.
happen. A lot of things go into making it work. It's possible. It's not too unlikely, but he's got to do that situation perfectly.
It's very important. It's actually very similar to where the Warrior can struggle against that second or even third anything. They're, you know, perfectly capable of staying above on the life total with all the armor. They don't usually have to worry about, you know, being killed outright by those Murlocs, but they are limited to only two brawls. So after you brawl the second time, and then if your opponent does happen to get that third anything can happen, you know, how do you live that third time? How do you remove the board? So the Paladin having very similar problems in this matchup, and we are going to get into the regame again. It's going to be Hotmouth versus Ruftrellin in the Paladin mirror. Ruftrellin, however, has the Nazoth build, while Hotmouth is working with the Murlocs, who have kind of been working against him this entire match.
Yeah, I mean, down 0-2 with it in the series so far. Doesn't have a win with it in this set, and just, it's not going to be a quick one, that's for sure. It's very hard for one player to mount an early offense with these
guys. Yes, absolutely. And at this point, you want to take it as slowly as possible. You want to give yourself the best chance, because the winner of this game is going to the America's Summer Championship. So much on the line for these guys, potentially a career. I mean, if that goes well, they would have the chance to go to BlizzCon.
Very big deal at this point. I mean, that's like the pinnacle of Hearthstone success. It's making it to the World Championship. Hotmouth going to elect to go with Blood Mage here. I imagine this will be spelling Acolyte of Pain as well. And then getting underway with card draw. So looks like the plan for Hotmouth this game is try to power cycle to the right cards. It's a lot of tools to pick up, but mm-hmm. it starts
you will pay for
with
that
the card draw.
Ruftrellin unhappy about that Acolyte play. Unlike last game, he does not have the True Silver to counter it. He doesn't have a Kodo, so looking like he's going to potentially... Okay, he's rethinking it.
I'm a little bit interested in this Wild Pyromancer play.
I almost would have played
just
the Aldor
nothing.
Peacekeeper or just done nothing.
Yeah, done nothing here. I mean, at this point, you're opening up Humility and Aldor Peacekeeper from Hotmouth to draw additional mm-hmm. cards. So just going to get outright rewarded here. Hotmouth's going to choose to run in the Acolyte instead of using True Silver Champion. So interesting that he's electing to just take one card draw for this. Could be fear of, of Coin Kodo, which would have just happened to be picked up by Roof Trellin. Maybe Hot Meow's just got, he's just got precognition. He can just see the future and know that the spider sense was tingling.
That is possible. But in this case, I think it's just Hot Meow, you know, having played through the majority of the last game, knowing that he did not have the cards that he needed in hand. In the last game, the Kodo did deny him even a single draw off of his second Acolyte. So in this case, definitely playing it a little bit safe, but also I think Hot Meow just saying, I need this card and I'm going to take it regardless of if I could potentially get more cards off of it, because I could also potentially get no cards off of it. In that case, that could be detrimental.
Yeah, Roof Trellin getting aggressive here. Because coin out the Sylvanas, attack for one. And we're kind of seeing the same game plan here from Roof Trellin as well. Just start pushing damage.
Hot Meowth is going to be able to clear it all off. Roof Trellin not going to get any minions off of the Sylvanas, but that is one Death Rattle that has died this game. That is one Death Rattle that will be resummoned by N'Zoth later in the game, which we do see in Roof Trellin's hand. Unfortunately, no Shifter Xeris quite yet.
Well,
I stand corrected.
Maybe you also have precognition and can see the future. Cora's spidey sense was tingling.
I hope so. 21 years without it has been hard enough. Let's just just start seeing the future from here.
21 years without being able to see the future. How on earth did you make it through life?
Slowly and blindly with no sense of what was going to happen. But Roof Trellin does have a sense of what's going to happen, and it's doom. Doom will happen if that Doomsayer goes off.
This is like deja vu right here.
The end is coming, and we're going to play another Cairn.
Jam Cairn into Doomsayer.
It worked the first time. Yep. You might as well.
We're trying to actually recreate the exact same situation from game one to game two.
That is the most fair way to do it. Let's just have the same exact turns. And Warhorse Trainer in Roof Trellin's hand
will immediately change.
Blade of C'Thun. Oh my goodness, if it was one turn later, that would have been...
If only he had C'Thun in the deck.
Why is the C'Thun N'Zoth Paladin variant not more popular, Admirable?
This is a tough situation, too. I mean, staring down the Ragnaros Lightlord, sure, Aldor Peacekeeper and a couple attacks will start to limit this,
options,
but if you look at the way that Roof Trellin's hand's panning out, that floats a lot of mana here. So he's actually just going to go for the clear. And I like the use of the Consecrate here as well. I mean, at this point, I think his hand is spelling aggression.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about having the tools to do the full board clears later in the game. This hand, I don't necessarily think, is spelling the time to make that happen. So keep the pressure test on Hot Meowth. So far, he hasn't really had to expend anything.
Yeah, last game was much more reactive. He didn't have the N'Zoth in hand, only had one Death Rattle. Oh my goodness. I do recall Frodan earlier on saying that the chance of getting something at four mana or higher was, I believe, something like 80%. And this is just the absolute opposite of what Hot Meowth wants to see. How do you make the best of this discovery?
It's probably Blessing of Wisdom. It doesn't have a potential to draw. I mean, it's not like a horrible card. It's just a difficult card to include in decks, because what's the purpose of the card? That's a tough thing to identify with it. So just take the Blessing of Wisdom. Hope you can get value at some point.
Hot Meowth chooses to save his true Silver Charge, even though he does have a second one in hand. But in this case, just valuing having a board decides a 4-1 minion is good enough to Alder.
New cards!
That is another new card. All right, we are actually seeing quite a few of them in this match. We saw the Firelands Portal. We've seen the Ivory Knight. And unfortunately,
Silver Moon Portal. Put that portal in your hand right now.
But can you really blame him? We were talking about how important the equality is off of the Ivory Knight for Roof Trellin.
He did already use one as well, so I think taking equality is a better play.
But is it the fun play? This is a guy who's playing Shifter Xeris in his Paladin deck, and he goes for the safe play. Smart.
I'm just saying.
But
I wanted to see the Piloted Shredder flashbacks of getting a Doomsayer from your random 2-drop effect. That's something I'm always looking forward to.
Just had a chill go down my spine, Admirable. Oof. Nightmares. But Hot Meowth, again, having the same problem that
Blessing
he's had in the last couple of games.
Looks pretty good here. I mean, honestly, in the right situation, this Blessing of Wisdom could draw him several cards.
Oh,
and that's one
goodness.
Of those situations. Two Consecrations will wipe this board presence out here. Now, I think he's going to use the True Silver Champion instead, but suddenly this 3-3 is a real threat to Ruthtrellan. He has no way to currently kill it, and that can draw Hot Meowth two cards a turn. This is a priority kill for Ruthtrellan right now.
But what can Ruthtrellan do? He's got the Argent Horse Rider.
But you need
to couple it with an Equality. I mean, that's... Can you really afford to do that?
I don't know if he can afford to let that live. That's terrifying.
Oh, my goodness. Does he have any other options? The Ivory Knight?
Ivory Knight into Hammer of Wrath.
Okay.
Ivory Knight into...
That would be great.
There's not a silence I can think of. I mean, do not blame him for Equality Argent Horse Riding this. If that happens, that Blessing of Wisdom landing is one of the worst things Ruthtrellan could have seen right now.
What he did so well in the last game was deny Hot Meowth those cards.
This is trouble. This is real trouble for Ruthtrellan.
What do you go with? We've seen a couple enter the Colosseums that just haven't done anything. Seal of Champions, okay, but your Argent Horse Rider is going to be gone next turn. You can't even use that to get immediate charge value. So what do you do? Eye for an eye. Oh my goodness, with those Murlocs, if you wait until the exact right moment to play it, Admirable, I just saw your eyes get really big.
The timing on that could actually, in a weird situation, be very significant. That's a really weird pick, but he's got a plan in mind. I mean, he's not just taking eye for an eye for no reason. The plan is quite literally to line that up against an anything can happen and hope that Hot Meowth is at a low enough life total that eye for an eye can return the kill.
I mean, Enter the Colosseum was going to likely do nothing. You've got that Equality in hand. You decided to save it. And Seal of Champions, I mean, what was Seal of Champions going to do? In some weird way, the Eye for an Eye pick could be the most impactful. And Gnomish Inventor coming down from Shifter Zeris. Not bad. Not bad.
So he picks up True Silver Champion, which is super important here. I mean, a lot of the damage has already been done by Blessing of Wisdom here. Mm-hmm. But this is still really tough. I mean, a lot of cards got drawn for Hot Meowth. I'm worried for Ruthtrellan in this game. I mean, the game plan has kind of been, it's a lot more thrown together than it was in the last game. Last game, he was so put together. He always had 10 cards in hand. Hot Meowth is on the back foot.
And now it's completely switched.
It feels like it's slipping away.
Hot Meowth is the one with the control. He's got all the cards in hand, and Ruthtrellan is forced to react.
So spectator client, a little bit of a technical issue here. We'll get that fixed as quickly as we can. Looks like Loot Hoarder and some stuff got cast. It was an immediate Tyrion and swing back. So as soon as we get the feed, there we go.
There we go.
Like magic.
All right, Tyrion Ford Ring coming down. And Ruthtrellan hitting with that True Silver to face, gain 2 health. If the Tyrion dies, you get the Ashbringer anyway, so might as well get the value while you still can.
Yeah, curious if there was ever merit to playing Doomsayer there. And then having the Tyrion make the 5-3 Ashbringer, and then just playing this off.
Oh my goodness.
You get Sylvanas, you get Cairn, anyway. you get Tyrion, you get the trifecta from that.
And then you have the 5-3 weapon regardless. Wow, that would have been somewhat of a really insightful play. Looks like he's gonna go ahead and try to do it this turn.
Yeah, still pretty likely to succeed, I think.
How would Hot Meowth prevent this?
Why is Eye for an Eye coming down now?
I don't like that at all.
Reporting for duty.
Oh, is he trying to bluff redemption here?
But would that even be... I mean, why would you want the redemption, even if the Tyrion is brought back? The Doomsayer still goes off. Maybe he just wants Hot Meowth to leave the board alone.
Hot Meowth is going to check for repentance. Doomsayer, at this point, Hot Meowth also just needs space in his hand. So, like, the Doomsayer is really just lost all of its value at this point. So, checks for repentance, that's not the case. He checked for Noble Sacrifice. That wasn't the case.
Competitive Spirit is a possibility.
Yep, limiting the options here at this point.
Sacred Trial as well.
Yep, kind of a Forbidden Healing here. And when he doesn't see Competitive Spirit goes off, and it can't be redemption on your own turn.
But do you remember Eye for an Eye? It's Eye for an Eye. Nobody plays it, and even the strange Secret Paladin builds that are somewhat around today, maybe not the least loved Paladin secret. Sacred Trial might get that award, but.
So Ruthtrellan going for the Ragnaros Lightlord here. This is two reasons why over the Nazoth. Number one, he wants to get more value from his Ashbringer in the case that his second Tyrion dies. Number two, he's trying to get any sort of removal from Hot Meowth right now. Say Hot Meowth looks at this and goes, This needs to be taken care of. It's 8 points of damage. It's going to keep him at 30. Maybe I have to equality this. If that happens, then Nuzoth looks a little bit better. Humility manages to take care of it very nicely, though.
Oh, man, Admirable, this is looking like Hot Meowth is firmly in the driver's seat. He has both copies of Pyromancer Equality. If that Nuzoth does come down, Griftrellin will get another Ashbringer. He'll get a 4-5 Cairn, and he'll be able to steal something from Hot Meowth's side of the board in theory because of the Sylvanas, but what can he do at this point?
I'm thinking it's just the Nuzoth and the hope. I mean, maybe you try to roll on the Kodo really well, but it's Nuzoth. And here we go. It's a huge board for Hot Meowth to deal with, but with Equality in hand, it is much, much easier and picks up another Murloc. Those are super important draws right now.
This is just absolutely the opposite of the way that last game was going. Griftrellin was in control the entire time, and there was certainly still an opportunity for Hot Meowth to take control and draw his Murlocs and win with those Anyfins, but it looked like Griftrellin was just ahead firmly in that last game, and now this game has been
there's that second Murloc, and honestly,
entirely different.
It's a pretty important pickup right now because sitting at 13 life, facing down 9 points of damage, he's got to find the way to win now. And drawing that second Murloc means that he can get to that anything can happen and roll it out in 2 straight turns coming after this. So those draws paramount at the moment.
Is there a possibility for Griftrellin to just go face and end up winning with that Eye for an Eye? I mean, is that a possibility?
Well, it's about to get checked right now. So down to 11, he's going down to 9.
Goodness, Griftrellin has 5.
I mean, fatigue damage is a real thing as well. Honestly,
have any more heal.
I wonder if you play the Wild Pyromancer and just try to attack for more.
Oh my goodness, Griftrellin hits face for 5, builds as big of a board as he can, and he's put Hot Meowth on a 1-turn clock. What can Hot Meowth do? Just when we thought this was Hot Meowth's game, those Ashbringers coming in so clutch for Griftrellin.
Griftrellin, it's just the aggression from it is really the important part there. I mean, Tyrion Deathrattle provides you with a lot of damage.
It's well another played. Equality. Hot Meowth doesn't have any health gain.
That's
He's
it.
He's going to play that Anyfin, and what looked like Hot Meowth's game, just with one Ashbringer, was so firmly thrown back into Rooftrellin's side. Oh my goodness. Rooftrellin completes the reverse sweep over Hot Meowth and is going to book his ticket to the America's Summer Championship. What a match, Admirable.
Yeah, what a tremendous fashion, too, to recognize the win condition just being pressure. You know, game one, he had a stranglehold on it. I think he could have waited. In game number two, it was kind of the ragtag crew of spells trying to get the job done. And timing the Tyrion was really important with the Nuzoth. You needed to, you wanted to try to get extra damage out of that in the face of a clear on that Tyrion. And that extra damage may have bought him the situation he needed. It's hard to say whether or not it would have been consequential in the other way around, but say he only got 5 points damage out of it and then he faced a full clear. Suddenly, maybe he doesn't have the same amount of damage to push out. Maybe he doesn't just keep drawing threats. Maybe Hot Meowth has perfect setup earlier. The timing was paramount to Griftrellin's success in that one, and we saw it in multiple of the games in this set.
Just absolutely insightful play, playing that Ragnaros Light Lord before the Nuzoth, trying to get just that extra 5 damage out of the Ashbringer, which I think added up to something like 15 in total by the end of the game. I mean, that's half of Hot Meowth's health just coming out of those Tyrion Death Rattles made such the absolute difference for Griftrellin. And we have an interview with Griftrellin standing by, so I'm going to toss it over to TJ at the blackboard.
Thanks, guys. Great job hanging in there. Another marathon of the series as we get done with our third match of the day. And Griftrellin is going to take it 3-2. Once again, sort of showing the weaknesses of Murloc Paladin. But I do have Griftrellin online for an interview. Hey, man, can you hear me?
Hey, TJ, how you doing?
Hey, man, doing great. Probably not as good as you, though. I want to ask you, how does it feel? You've been in the scene for as long as I can remember. How does it feel to make it to that championship?
It feels great. This has been like my first real tournament, but I wasn't expecting to do this well.
Yeah,
so I'm pretty happy.
Yeah, you brought some interesting decks. I want to ask you right away, what was the craziest Shifter Xeris you had? How did that card perform in your Paladin deck throughout the course of the weekend?
One time when I was, this weekend I really haven't gotten to play it. The craziest one I've had on ladder is getting a turn 10 variant into Ragnaros and Cairn. but I haven't gotten to play it at all until this matchup in the tourney.
Well, the Bog Creeper was pretty nice in that first matchup before the disconnect, but it had some MVP moments. Talk to me a little bit about your lineup overall. You brought a little bit interesting lineup. What made you decide on Nazoth Paladin and the rest of your decks with that weird tempo mage?
Well, mostly I was trying to. I figured everybody would have a warrior, right? So I figured I'd play decks that I'm good at, that I played a lot, and tech them to beat warrior. And like the cowboy guy, cowboys, I fought, I 3-0'd his warrior, and I don't know if I've lost a single warrior match, so it's been working.
Yeah, it was the most popular deck in the tournament, so it was a good strategy to ban that. Last question, do you have anybody you'd like to thank, anybody you'd like to give a shout out to before I let you go?
Yeah, I'd like to thank my girlfriend, Michaela, because I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for her, like, cheering me on. And I'd like to thank Lyman Knobboard for practicing with me. And I'd like to thank Jeff, because he's a cool guy.
Cool guy, Jeff. Thanks, man. Congratulations. I look forward to seeing you at the America Championship.
All right, thanks. I'm pumped.